my idea of an ordinary guy is somebody quite sort of tall, dark-haired, with a sort of slightly disconnected view of the world, who works for the BBC. But I was always kind of interested in science fiction, and I was also interested in the way that comedy and science fiction would fit together. There seemed to be, to me, to be a natural. And everybody told me at the time, of course, it couldn't be done, because, and here's why not, if it could be done, it would have been done already. But I came up at one point with a whole series of different ideas, different single story ideas, each of which ended with the world being destroyed for a different reason. The title, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, came to me before I went up to university, and I was hitchhiking around Europe. But I then forgot about it. It just seemed to be a good title for a book, and I thought somebody ought to write that one day. It didn't actually occur to me it would be me. I wanted to be a writer, and I was doing bits and pieces here and there, a little bit of radio, a little bit of television. Scarcely managing to pay the bills and floundering around trying to find the right way forward. I wasn't someone to whom it came naturally to write to order. I kind of needed the chance to go and explore my own universe. And it was in the end one particular producer who kind of took up my case and decided that, maybe I had something.
Rolling.
Listen, you stupid machine, it tastes filthy. Here, take this cup back.
If you have enjoyed the experience of this drink, why not share it with your friends?
Radio is a very, very important medium in England, and we're fantastically lucky, because that's where an awful lot of drama and comedy and so on still happens.
Will you try and comprehend what I'm telling you?
And as far as I was concerned, I mean, I had the opportunity to do something that wouldn't have been presented any other way. We spent months and months and months making these six radio programs.
If you ask the audience to believe you're listening to 2 million robots, then provided you aren't actually listening to just one voice, then they're prepared to go along with you.
I think for the whole year's work that I spent writing the six episodes and then making them, I was paid probably about $1,500 for that. And it was actually one of the best times of my life. I mean, I was absolutely penniless, sort of sleeping on friends' couches and so on. But it was just extraordinarily exciting. A publisher heard it, said you'd write a book, so I wrote the book, and the book came out. And nobody had any idea whether the book was going to work or not, but I'd been asked to go along and do a signing session at a little science fiction store. So I went along, got in a taxi, went along, couldn't get there, because there seemed to be something happening in the centre of London that was causing sort of crowds and traffic jams, and it turned out it was for the signing session. It was for me. I could not. I mean, it was from being a complete nobody to being at the centre of a maelstrom in 24 hours. And then the next day, got the Sunday paper, and the book was number one on the bestseller list first week, and stayed there for weeks and weeks and weeks. Well, I never actually thought of myself as a prescient science fiction writer. I didn't see that as my job, so I never saw myself as Arthur C. Clarke, who was an engineer who actually specifically invented and developed the idea of the communication satellite, and then used fiction, if you like, to evangelize that idea, and did that brilliantly. I was never in that mold, and really my things were purely story driven. So when I came up with the idea of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, it was simply a way of solving certain story issues, and also a way of gathering up all those sort of little story ideas that tend to sort of spark off the flywheel when you're inventing. And I needed something to contain all those. And then, having found the need for that, I then, in a very, very quick and simple way, just sort of copied bits of technology around at the time, the pocket calculator, television remote, and all that kind of stuff. Most of it's silly technology. Thank you. fish, the translating fish, was simply a reaction to the observation that I grew up with Doctor Who and then I guess a little bit of Star Trek, where every alien race in the entire galaxy always speaks English. This can't be the case, really. And you feel you can't just cheat your way through that. You've got to come up with something. I think there's certainly evidence that life does imitate art, particularly at the moment when we have a generation of scientists and technologists who were brought up on science fiction. And it very much formulated the idea, their ideas of what's possible. The ideas we have about what the future is going to be like formulate the way we move forward. So it's very important that we have the most positive view of what the future will be. So, you have to look at where you actually want to go, not where you're frightened that you might end up. So if we allow ourselves to be hypnotized by the Blade Runner view of the future, where everything will look like rusty Los Angeles, then that's what we'll get. But on the other hand, if we see the technologies that are coming along at the moment as things that we are actively involved in creating and using and thinking creatively and constructively about in the best possible way, then we're more likely to get something great coming out of it. I was the only child anybody had ever seen walk into a lamppost in broad daylight. So my mother just hoped there was something going on the inside, because there didn't seem to be much evidence of it from the outside. I was always fantastically tall. This meant when I was a kid, if we'd go on a school expedition somewhere, the teacher would always say, well, at 4 o'clock, whereas normally would say, at 4 o'clock, meet under the clock tower or whatever, they'd say at 4 o'clock, meet under Adams. I was born in Cambridge in 1952, and my initials are DNA. And as you may or may not remember, the DNA double helix was discovered in Cambridge, actually a few months later, just at the beginning of 1953. So I got there first. I lived with my mother and my sister and my mother's parents. Now, my grandmother was the local representative of the RSPCA, the Royal Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals. It meant that the house was continually full of an incredible collection of animals, all of whom were damaged in some way, either physically or psychologically. This had an unfortunate effect on me in early life, because I suffered from terrible asthma, and I would sneeze about once every 10 seconds throughout my entire childhood. There was a pigeon that lived in the house. I mean, my mother was completely outraged about this, because wherever we went in the house, there was evidence of, shall we say, the pigeon having been there. And as far as I was concerned, as a kid, I assumed everybody had pigeons flapping around their houses. But and there was this wonderful dog, which was a Pomeranian terrier. Now, Pomeranian terrier, one of these very, very tiny little animals, with a vicious streak about the size of the Grand Canyon. And basically what it would do all day is bark. Bark ferociously, angrily, bitterly, and nobody could go near it because it was such a vicious little thing. Now, the curious thing was, as I say, all these animals were damaged, either physically or psychologically, and this one was kind of both. It had a cerebral hemorrhage as a young puppy, which meant that, first of all, its head was always on one side, and B, though it barked and yapped viciously and furiously, it couldn't actually bite. It couldn't bite. And the thing was, I mean, if you got your finger in its mouth, you go, and suddenly the poor thing would be rather deflated. But the interesting thing was, even though we knew it couldn't bite, you couldn't get near it. So you begin to sort of see the sort of sense of complete mayhem in which he was growing up in this relatively small house full of these completely insane animals, with me just sort of sneezing my way through it. I guess I've always had a vivid imagination, but it's always hard to know, because you've never had somebody else, you've only ever inhabited your own brain, you've never inhabited anybody else's, so you don't have a control group. I would say I've certainly always been a sort of slightly sort of dreamy sort of person. The humour, as I say, I mean, I think a lot came from my mother. I think one of my prime memories is actually week after week trying to find new ways of getting out of games, because I was terrible. I mean, I was hopeless. Hopeless at football. But we also had this game called rugby football, which is a bit like American football, but without all the armour and without all the commercial breaks. So it's basically just you and your t-shirt and your shorts. And everybody gets hurt really quite a lot and quite badly, because we all behave as if we're all wearing armour, but aren't. But my prime memory of it was that in the first 5 minutes of the first match I ever played, I broke my own nose on my own knee, which is quite a feat in itself, really. And the sad thing about that is that since that point, even though I've had several operations on it, it's never really admitted very much in the way of air. So my nose is actually, these days, purely decorative. But it's also quite good occasionally for sort of keeping one steady, walking through a sort of heavy wind. I think the internet so far has been all promise and not enough delivery. And we are still very, very much hampered by the technology of the internet. And I'm using the word technology in the Danny Hillis sense, because Danny famously said that technology is our name for stuff that doesn't work yet. I mean, it's 56K modems. You've got to crawl under the desk, plugging things into other things, and it's a nightmare. We've struggled with it because of the promise. But, you know, we're beginning to get a little bit tired, I think, of all the struggle and very little of the delivery. I think the biggest misconception about the web is thinking that there's somebody else in charge, and there isn't. The internet is just us.
This begins a new generation of computers.
I think the next wave, when it comes, we get rid of this technology, in quotation marks, and start just having stuff that works. You'll know when it works because it won't come in a box. When you're able to buy a PDA in the same way you buy a pencil, you know, we don't buy pencils in boxes unless you buy a bunch of them, because they work. We don't have to have any of the other stuff to make it work. So when we have devices that are just take the internet for granted, when that is just omnipresent and just as natural as the air we breathe, then we'll be beginning to arrive at what's been promised. But at the moment, we're just in that disappointment phase. Because there were so many different projects I wanted to do, whether it was film, TV, you know, computer games and so on. Well, here's a bunch of people I would really love to be able to work with on a regular basis. You know, why don't we create a production house that can do all the stuff, and I'll feed all my projects through it? Now, it's a kind of wonderful idea, but it turns out that there are all kinds of problems that this brings about in the real world. To be honest, we bit off more than we could chew.
Tickets, please! Show your passports!
Starship Titanic started because many years ago I'd done a game based on The Hitchhiker's Guide, and I loved working on that. It was enormous fun to do, and it was basically myself and one other guy.
Hi, I'm Craig.
What we decided to do in this game is go for the non-psychopath sector of the market, you know. And you know, that was a little hubristic, because there really isn't a non-psychopath sector of the market, it turns out. What I didn't realize was that instead of two people taking 6 months, it took 30 people 2 years, including us. I had no idea it was going to be that kind of cost of time and energy and so on. And of course, being one of 30 people, you know, you don't in the end have the same degree of input and control and shaping as if it's just two of you. So, I think in all sorts of ways it was a great game, but it was too ambitious. It took too much of the company's resources.
Titanic, no, I'm afraid the word means nothing to me.
H2G2 was the website that we created at the Digital Village, and H2G2 was basically an attempt to create in the real world something based on the original Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. So the idea was, because the web allows people to share information, and that's its most powerful aspect, that we would build a guide that grew out of people's use of it. So people take stuff from the guide and they put it back in. So it's a collaborative guide that would just grow and grow and grow the more people used it. Unfortunately, like most brilliant dot-com companies, it was founded on the brilliant mathematical notion that if you multiply zero by a sufficiently large number, you've got something, which turns out not to be the case. Luckily, the BBC stepped in and actually bought the assets of the website, so the website continues to be what it was. But alas, the Digital Village now is no more. My fascination with technology kind of converges with several other fascinations, and prime amongst them would be that of evolutionary biology.
Well, I'm a zoologist, and I first met Douglas in the mid-80s when we actually worked together on a book called Last Chance to See.
Well, Last Chance to See, I embarked upon, not knowing quite why I wanted to do it, but knowing that I really, really did. I guess I figured it out afterwards, which is that as a science fiction writer, I've always been terribly, terribly interested in seeing how very familiar things look from unfamiliar points of view. How do you change your point of view? How do you change your perspective and suddenly see, you know, the truth of something?
So we hatched a plan to then go and travel around the world for as long as we could, and we worked out a sort of route that would have lasted about 18 months, and this became a project known as Last Chance to See, where we literally went around the world looking for endangered animals that are so close to extinction it could well be our last chance to see them. Now, he'd done a lot of travelling, but it was sort of author tour type travelling, where the publisher put him up in really plush hotels, and he hadn't slept in many jungles before, on the decks of many boats. And I think the thing about it was he surprised himself by surviving the experience and actually quite enjoying the experience. We looked at altogether 8 different species around the world in 7 different countries. And I think there's a few that really stood out for both of us. And I know one of Douglas's favourites was the kakapo, which was a parrot living in New Zealand. And as we used to describe it, it's the world's least able to fly parrot. And it can't fly, and not only can it not fly, it's forgotten that it can't fly. And so, as Douglas used to say, it used to climb up trees if it was frightened, jump out, flap its wings, and then fly like a brick and land on the ground. So that really appealed to him.
I found when I went to do Last Chance to See, the thing that most interested me was trying to enter into the world of an animal, by which I mean to say, trying to imagine what it was like for it, you know, being this size and having 4 legs and having a different kind of brain and a different kind of perceptions. Now, the thing is, you never can make that journey. You never can enter into a different kind of mind. But the attempt to do so is very, very illuminating.
He had a brilliant mind. I mean, he was a real big thinker. And in fact, I was almost sometimes embarrassed being with him, because I felt so hopeless against the way he thought about things, his knowledge about everything. And, you know, it's a really humbling thing spending a lot of time travelling with him, because he just did seem to have this great depth.
And I once came across a zoologist at Oxford University who said, I really want to thank you for writing that book, because it always used to be that people would ask me why I wanted to be a zoologist, and I could never explain it. Now I give them that book and they say, oh, I get it. I think I'd quite like to be a rock star, and I think I'm nearly old enough now. So that's one major remaining ambition. It's funny, there are all sorts of things and I wish I could have been, but I'm very happy with what I did do. What I would like to be when I grow up is a clone, so there can be about half a dozen of me, and one would be a rock star, one would be an evolutionary biologist, a software engineer, and one would probably stay in bed all day watching movies. Success can be enormously invigorating and give you huge confidence to do all sorts of things you otherwise wouldn't do. But also it can be a huge burden as well, and stuff you've got to live up to, and you're not quite certain if you can do that. You know, it's very much a two-edged sword. And in the meantime, I've actually got a huge backlog of new story ideas. I mean, when I stopped writing novels a few years ago, I just kind of ran out a bit because, my books tend to use up ideas at a fairly ferocious rate. And now I've got a huge backlog of ideas, and it's just a question of sort of getting them done. So I'm really enjoying, hammering the old keyboards again. I keep on finding myself drawn to be writing slightly sort of apparently vague and daffy old men who have little barbs of sudden unexpected truth in sort of long screeds of burbling. I'm gonna be just like that, aren't I?